Tonight on Our Century, the defeat of distance. From those trailblazers who opened up this vast land by train and by plane and by camel, through to the jet setters of the 60s and beyond.
When this couple were first married, they could still travel in a horse cab. But today, they're trying flying for the first time.
This is the century Aussies took a deep breath and really started going places.
All aboard!
Now, we live on the biggest island in the world, at the bottom of the world. And our biggest problem, apart from flies and cicadas, has always been distance. Distance from the rest of the world and distance from each other. In 1901, Federation actually glued the states together, at least on paper. But that wouldn't mean anything unless we could get from one part of the country to another. And before we could actually start going places, we had to overcome the tyranny of distance. Now, that would be the challenge of the century. It must have been something in the water. Whatever it was, we opened this new century with a baby boom. Our population suddenly sprouted, growing by nearly a third in just 10 years. And they went off to see the world. But only the very rich got to go overseas. The ticket cost too much, and besides, London was at least 5 weeks on a boat. So most of us had to find our fun locally. In the 1920s and 30s, that meant a day trip or a camping holiday. They were all the rage.
Let's make up and still be friends. Let's get what it takes for two. Let's kiss and you'll realize I'm having love with you.
But anyone lucky enough to get a holiday didn't go far from the coast, up to the Blue Mountains, or the Dandenongs, or the Mount Lofty Ranges. Only the most intrepid traveller dared to cross the Great Divide.
They called it the Never Never Country, the back of beyond.
In 1927, this brave bunch set out on a 5,000 kilometre tour of the Outback. It was admittedly a sort of junket. Nothing's changed. Politicians and top businessmen taxied around by a dusty fleet of Dodge limos to another world. Places with funny names like Udnadatta and the Alice. The idea was to show off the untold and untapped resources of the bush. They called them Rezzo tours. And these tarted up city slickers suddenly saw themselves as frontiersmen, taking on the Australian Wild West. These Rezzo tourists could only survive out here with the 12 tons of petrol and supplies carried in, not by cars, but by camels. Camels had been shipped here back in the 1860s to deal with the 3 million square kilometres of Australia's deserts, making white settlement possible. The Cameleers came from what was then northern India, but we call them Afghans. It seemed close enough.
Where water is scarce, those sturdy desert ships are man's best friend.
The camels call this home. They ship supplies to the sheep stations and to the mines. Then they came back with a full load of wool or of minerals.
Seven iron houses burning in the sun between two deserts.
By the 1950s, the camel trains were history. But the outposts that they'd served, like Birdsville, were still just as isolated and just as forgotten.
Corrugated iron towns shimmering in the corrugated air. The retreat of men and women from the immensity of sand.
And for the cattle stations at the top end, the horizon stretched all the way to hell.
Supplies and mail for lonely cattle stations. Stations measured by thousands of miles, where the man living 100 miles away is your neighbor. And your only link with the outside world is Her Majesty's Royal Mail.
By the early 1900s, our cities had world-class public transport. Trams ruled the roads, crisscrossing the suburbs. But outside the cities, well, good luck. The only thing that could tame the wide brown land was the railway. In fact, Western Australia only agreed to federation in 1901 if the rail link was built, joining west with east. Work began on the Transcontinental Railway in 1912. It was a mammoth engineering task, and nothing like it had ever been tried before. Sunday was the only day of rest. They didn't even slow down for World War I, and in 1917, it was finally finished. The biggest inland towns and most of the capital cities were now linked by the railway line. The good news was that you could travel now by train all the way from Brisbane to Perth. The bad news was you had to change trains 6 times to do it.
Albury, all change!
The state governments all agreed that Australia had to have a railway. A railway that spanned the country. That was the easy part. What they couldn't agree on was how wide to make the railway tracks. Now, it'd be silly to make them the same, so they made them different sizes.
Wake the children.
Grab the luggage.
Find the ticket.
Get a porter.
We're changing trains.
We're changing gauge. This is the border. This is the barrier between the states.
I want to stay in this train.
But we can't be it.
Why?
Because we have to change into another one.
Why?
Because this is as far as this one goes.
Why?
Because, oh, because it wants a rest. I don't know. Come on.
Even a child knew how dopey it was to have different railway gauges from state to state. During World War II, we had to move the army. But of course, the soldiers had to change trains as they crossed state borders.
Look at the map. The Japs did. They saw the broken gauge between the states and laughed at the hopeless bottlenecks. Laughed at the line shrunk to 3 feet 6 in the west, but suddenly stopped and changed to 4 feet 8 and a half to cross the Nullarbor.
It was an absurd situation, and there was only one solution.
Standardize.
Standardize. Standardize.
Incredibly, it was 1970 before Australia had one standard gauge railway across the country.
In just a few minutes, the first non-stop passenger train across the continent of Australia from Sydney to Perth is due to leave Central Station.
It had taken almost a century, but the magic width that the authorities finally agreed on was 4 feet 8 and a half inches.
For the Indian Pacific, she goes a-rolling down the track. 5,000 miles to travel before she's there and back.
The excitement and the fanfare of that first run by the Indian Pacific was like an echo from glorious days long gone. The golden age of trains was the 1920s, a time when travelling by rail was doing it in style. When the Duke and Duchess of York toured in 1927, well, there was only one way to go. When a train pulled into faraway places like Mount Isa, then everybody turned up. Trains brought the outside world into town. A lot of these places wouldn't have survived if they hadn't been connected to the rest of Australia by rail.
Turkeys, ducks, onions, apples, fowls, chicken, sheep and cattle.
The 1940s was the peak of our train age, and 90% of our wheat and our sheep were transported by rail. And where the train line went, the new towns would spring up. By the 1960s, just about every part of Australia had its own local identity.
The logging special, the Goonamble Mail,
the Sunlander, the Inlander, the Overland, the Gap, Mildura Sunlight, Spirit of Progress, Westland, Australia, the Southern Aurora. They are names bringing travel, sunlight, and the dream of distance to all Australian minds.
But if just one symbolised what it all meant, then maybe it was this one. Nicknamed the Tea and Sugar Train, it was almost a town on wheels.
The train is the village store, the bank, and the health centre for the rail workers and others living along the 1,100-mile track between Port Augusta and Kalgoorlie.
For as far as the eye could see and beyond, it ran in a dead straight line. And they say that on a clear night, you could see the lights of the Tea and Sugar Train 2 hours before it passed.
The Tea and Sugar makes 50 stops on its weekly run. And for the housewives at Pimber, it's a welcome visitor. For besides household needs, it brings a welfare car with a doctor and nurse, polio immunisation and chest X-ray surveys. When the payroll for the rail workers is on board, there's always the risk of a train robbery.
As well as being the lifeline to the outback, trains were also fun, sending Aussies on holiday further than they'd ever been before.
Something has caught his eye. Youngsters from the cattle station have challenged the Gann to a race. They gallop across the bare dry plain at high speed. What a picture they make, and what a setting.
It's exciting when these brave little craft go up, but it's even more exciting when they come down. Look out there!
They've sometimes been a bit wobbly, but aeroplanes have had a bigger impact in our country than just about any place on Earth. When Ross and Keith Smith winged their way to Australia from England in 1919, they heralded a new era that brought the world to our doorstep. Closer to home, it had been the bush pilots who blazed a trail to the outback towns, bringing fresh produce to our most forgotten areas. Letters and newspapers were no longer months old when they arrived. In 1920, Joy Flights offered those who could afford it the experience of a lifetime.
Wish me luck as you wave me goodbye. Cheerio, here I go on my way. Wish me luck as you wave me goodbye. Not a tear.
10 minutes in the air for £3.15. Now that was about a week's pay for the average battler. And if you were really well off and had nothing better to do, you could wing it from Melbourne to Hay, stop for a cup of tea while the pilot refilled, and still be home for cocktails. Planes opened up a whole new frontier. Aerial scientific surveys of the outback became pioneering adventures.
Below is the camp, and here is the aerodrome, which was cleared by blacks, the women being by far the best workers. Some of the grass cleared from the aerodrome was used for making beds.
And there was the birth of a national institution. In November 1920, the Queensland and Northern Territory Air Service made its humble beginning. Just 7 years later, Qantas claimed to have flown as far as the moon and back. And planes fired the public's imagination. The newspapers were filled with thrilling accounts of the flights of Amy Johnson and Bert Hinkler, of Smithy and Ulm, as they competed to break each other's records.
Ulm brought his plane from England to Australia in 6 days, 17 hours, beating the week-old record made by his comrade, Sir Charles Kingsford Smith.
Flights like this made great headlines, but the real aim was to prove that flying wasn't just for daredevils and for joyriders, it was for everybody.
Ours was more an endeavour to demonstrate that still can be done in a big machine in pretty fast time, try and demonstrate the commercial possibilities.
By the 1930s, the airlines were running regular passenger services between most of our capital cities. Brisbane to Sydney, 6 hours. Sydney to Melbourne, just 4 hours. Australia was suddenly shrinking.
The wireless operator taps out a message telling Darwin to the minute, the time when we will land. We are almost across the great breadth of Australia, compressing into hours, distances that once meant weeks of weary travel.
But there were tragic setbacks. On March the 21st, 1931, came the news that no one wanted to hear.
The Southern Cloud, with six passengers and a crew of two, flew south, meeting 100-mile-an-hour headwinds, and was never seen again. For weeks, other planes searched over rugged country like this. Ground parties tried to penetrate the forest, but the mystery of the Southern Cloud remained unsolved.
It was our first civil aviation disaster, and a grim reminder that flying could still be dangerous. The wreckage of the Southern Cloud remained hidden in the snowy mountains for 27 years.
Experts examining the debris say the passengers and crew thrown forward into the cockpit by the impact died instantly.
The Southern Cloud disaster couldn't have come at a worse time. Australia was in the grips of the Depression. Flying was expensive anyway, and now there was a question about its safety. But the airlines fought back, and by the late 1930s, public confidence was once again up.
All aboard!
Flying, in fact, acquired a certain elegance, but it certainly wasn't cheap. A return flight to London cost nearly £600, at a time when the average wage was less than £5 a week.
Well, patience is necessary, even when travelling at 200 miles per hour.
After World War II, flying got cheaper. In the 50s, when jet engines replaced propellers, a new age of aviation had arrived.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the first of the two fan jets, the Ansett A&A Boeing 727 fan jet, is approaching to land.
By the 1960s, the pressurized 727s could ferry hundreds of passengers across Australia and across the world.
It's the jet age now, and it's the best jet for this type for inside Australia, the best jet in the world, and it's as fast as anything in the world. So it's the best, and it's just good enough for Australia.
Reg Ansett dominated Australian aviation and some of our politicians for nearly half a century. In 1929, Reg picked up pilot's license number 419, and he started his transport empire with a taxi service, just a trusty Studebaker. He saved enough money to buy his first plane in 1935. It cost £1,000, but he never looked back. Now, the best way for a young flyer to raise cash in those days was to win air races, and that's exactly what Reg did, to get his new airline off the ground. In 1936, Ansett Airlines made its first flight from Hamilton in Victoria to Melbourne. Reg was one of six passengers on board that day. The flight took just under 2 hours. Reg Ansett brought flying within the reach of middle Australia.
When this couple were first married, they could still travel in a horse cab. But today, as an anniversary highlight, I believe, they're trying flying for the first time.
In 1952, Prime Minister Menzies brought in the two airline policy to guarantee fair competition with the government-owned TAA. A two-horse race where the ultimate winner was tourism. Aussies set out to explore their own country as never before.
Fly! Up and away!
In the jet-setting 60s and 70s, flying built up an image of affordable glamour. And these days, of course, planes are called Airbuses, and jet-setters have become almost as common as commuters. It's taken the best part of the century to defeat the great distances from the sea to the back of beyond. But one of the great rewards has been tourism.
Wai Wai, the Venice of Australia. Pleasure boats are everywhere, filled with happy people enjoying themselves.
Today, it's a $50 billion industry. One in nine jobs is connected to tourism.
A man of travel, I've had my share, man, I've been everywhere. Been to Talamore, Seymour, Lismore, Mooloolaba, Nambour, Mooch, Dorkill, Moomrillaba, Birdsville, Emmerville, Wallaville, Conowana, Conowine, Strathbrine, Frostbine, Nala, Dala, Darwin, Ginger, Nilliquin, Muckdilla, Wallamilla, Bogavilla, Cumberilla, I'm a killer, I've been everywhere, man, I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare man, I've breathed the mountain air, man of travel, I've had my share, man, I've been everywhere.
Maybe it's because we're so isolated. Maybe that's why Australians travel more than anyone in the world. Remember, at the turn of the century, It was only prime ministers and rich folk who could afford to go overseas. But we've overcome that particular tyranny of distance. Today, some of us go for business, but most of us go for pleasure. Like Paul Ruckert of Brisbane, whom we've featured quite a few times in the series. Now, Paul never leaves home without his credit card or his movie camera.
After a long hike, our adventure arrives at a tropical island and stops to admire the beautiful sandy beaches. The charming beaches are lined with well-kept holiday homes. This character came a long way for his holiday. His favourite pastime is swimming, and away he zips in search of water. He's not deterred at all. He wants a swim, and a swim he's determined to have. If the idiot would only cut out the pooling, he'll be worn out before he finds any water.